Bhopal Disaster. The amount of death and trauma experienced by the residents of Bhopal, India, has made their city the home of the world's worst industrial disaster. On the night of December 2nd, 1984, families living in the slums of Bhopal, India, woke up to find themselves trapped in a nightmare. The nearby Union Carbide India Limited pesticide plant was leaking deadly methyl isocyanate gas into the air, blanketing the neighborhoods of Bhopal in a choking cloud of poison. Amidst the confusion and terror, one lucky family was saved by an unlikely hero, their kitten. Welcome to Dark History, where we unravel the most disastrous events in history. If you want to support the channel, consider subscribing and like this video. For Famida Saeed and her daughter, Faiza, the evening started out no different than any other night. There were no warnings and no hints of the nightmare that lay ahead for the residents of the slums around Bhopal. While the mother and daughter pair slept side by side in their bed, a brisk December wind rolled across the city, bringing with it a cloud of toxic gas billowing from a leak at the pesticide plant Union Carbide India Limited. While Famida and Faiza, along with 900,000 other people in the area, rested in their beds, the night shift workers at the Union Carbide pesticide plant began to notice something amiss. The Union Carbide plant was set on 17 acres in the northeast outskirts of Bhopal, India. At first glance, the plant looked like a tangle of storage tanks, dilapidated sheds, small buildings, and long pipes, with a generous heap of concrete and barbed wire spread throughout the whole scene. If this sounds like a heap of safety hazards, that's because it was. By the beginning of December 1984, most of the plant's safety features were either broken or failing. Though the plant employed 650 workers and produced 2,500 tons of pesticides annually, it was not strictly maintained. Methyl isocyanate, otherwise known as MIC, was produced and contained at the facility in underground storage tanks. The MIC was in liquid form, and Union Carbide plant regulations stated that each of the three MIC tanks could be no more than half full at any given time. To keep impurities and moisture out of the tanks, the empty space above the liquid was pressurized with inert nitrogen gas. The pressurization also allowed the tanks to be drained as needed, allowing MIC to be removed without any dangers. Unfortunately for the families living in Bhopal, one of the three tanks had lost the ability to maintain pressure in October of that year. This left 42 tons of MIC sitting in the tank unprotected from impurities and moisture, and unable to be pumped out. You might be wondering why it was so important that MIC be protected from moisture while residing in the underground tanks. This volatile compound changes into a deadly gas when it comes into contact with H2O. When water touches MIC, it creates an instant chemical reaction that produces methylamine and carbon dioxide, along with quite a bit of heat. Can you guess where this is going? Somehow, on this horrible night, water entered a side pipe running to the unpressurized tank of MIC. The iron from the corroding pipes mixed with the water to create a runaway exothermic reaction. In simple terms, something really bad was happening in that tank. The families of Bhopal were still sleeping peacefully while the night shift workers noted the pressure in the tank had suddenly risen to 10 psi around 11 p.m. "That tank is broken," they noted. "Surely this is just an instrument error." The workers decided to take a tea break. After their break, around 12:40 a.m., the workers returned to see that the pressure had reached an alarming 55 psi. At this point, the deadly gas had already begun venting from a burst pressure relief valve on the tank. What exactly were the missing safety features that should have saved the residents of Bhopal that night? Refrigeration had been designed to cool the gas and slow down reactions in case of contamination. But 2 years prior, the refrigeration system had broken and the refrigerant had been removed. A flare tower should have been in place to burn off any escaping MIC gas. A connecting pipe had been removed recently for maintenance, and what remained were pipes not large enough to handle the amount of overflowing gas. Something called a vent gas scrubber was there to apply caustic soda to any leaks. Unfortunately, it was set to standby mode and didn't have enough power or caustic soda to neutralize the massive leak. It was at this point in time the wind began to carry 40 tons of MIC in the air over the sleeping slums of Bhopal, spreading over 40 square kilometers of the city. At 12:50 a.m., an alarm was sounded inside the plant to alert the workers. They quickly evacuated upwind from the leak. A related alarm sounded briefly over the city, but it was quickly disconnected, leaving the families completely unaware. Calls to the city's police were made, reassuring them that everything was fine. By 2 a.m., the leak had petered out, leaving a heavy cloud of toxic gas wrapped around the homes of Bhopal like fog. It was at this moment Famida and her daughter Faiza were jolted awake by unusual hoarse cries from their five-month-old kitten, Polly. The mother and daughter had been sleeping under blankets in their small home with all of the doors and windows shut. Just one window above their heads was left ajar for fresh air. Polly began jumping on their bed, growling, coughing, and rasping out frantic meows. Famida looked closely at Polly in the dimly lit room and saw the kitten was foaming at the mouth. She realized there were thick white clouds curling into the room through the cracked window. Polly knew exactly what to do to save herself. She dove under the blankets on the bed and hid with Faiza. Famida should have done the same, but she could hear screams and cries from her neighbors in the street as the gas blinded and choked them while they ran in confusion. She made her way to the bedroom door. The white clouds of gas had filled their drawing room. Famida was unable to breathe and became confused. She later said she was sure her last moments had come. Suddenly, she heard the sound of scratching and meowing at the door. With her last bit of strength, she opened the door only to find her sister's cat, Shanu. Along with Shanu came a miraculous breeze of fresh air, which revived Famida. She credits the cats Polly and Shanu with saving their lives. Famida's sister later told her that Shanu had saved her family's lives as well, waking them in time to escape just as Polly had done for Famida. While Famida survived only with mitopia in her eyes, many of her neighbors were not so lucky. Many of the slum dwellers were from the untouchable class, the lowest of the low people in society. No effort was made to get them out of harm's way. They were generally uneducated, and most of them had no idea what was happening when they woke to find themselves surrounded by a toxic fog. In blind panic, everyone ran out of their homes and into the streets. The elderly and children were left behind. Many people were overcome by clouds of gas in the streets and fell down, dying where they lay. No one could see, no one could breathe. Thousands of people trampled each other in a blind stampede in the foggy darkness. Cars driven by the wealthier families, desperate to escape, ran over bodies of humans and animals in the roads. The panic was heightened by police vans blaring sirens and loudspeakers in the fray. "Run, run, poison gas is spreading." The cloud of deadly fumes continued to spread through the city, enveloping the train station and killing everyone it touched. At the nearby hospital, doctors and nurses frantically tried to save lives, but officials hadn't explained to them what the deadly gas was made of, so they had no antidote. They were recording one death per minute among the patients before they just gave up counting. By morning, the streets were filled with bodies. More dead lay in their beds inside of their homes, never even waking to try and escape. It's estimated that 8,000 to 10,000 people perished in the Union Carbide industrial accident on that horrible night. Thousands more were left disfigured, blinded, and permanently disabled. And most pregnant women miscarried. Though the incident happened more than 30 years ago, the effects continue on to this day. The groundwater contamination has continued to poison subsequent generations, leaving thousands of second and third generation children with a range of disabilities not seen anywhere else in India. Cerebral palsy, muscular dystrophy, Down syndrome, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, blindness, learning difficulties, and gross motor delay are very common. Many children have more than one condition. The city states that the gas leak was under control in just 8 hours. However, more than 30 years later, the residents of Bhopal are still struggling to escape the toxic grip of the world's worst industrial disaster. I hope you found this video interesting. If you did, please like and subscribe. See you next time.